Friends, hope you're doing well. My name is Dr. Milind Chinde, MD pediatric from IIMS Bhopal. So today we are going to talk about a very favorite topic of PG aspirants, all PG aspirants, about grant test. That what is the best way to analyze the grant test and how to improve our outcome. So I will be sharing few thoughts and a few of my concepts, like how should we ideally analyze the grant test and what is the best way to analyze it. So guys, I'll just share with you. I have made a few slides. So these slides will help you in analyzing this information. So first of all, grant test, you are all, I think, are giving the grant test, and you should know that how one should approach. So first, we should know what is grant test. So grant test is actually, it's like nearly there are, depending on the exam pattern, there are around 300 questions or 200 questions which comprise which are from all the subject. This is for a kind of practice MCQs to give you practice about how the exam is going to happen. Okay, so it is give you, it's like a practice session. Now when to start giving grant test, the first thing I want to tell you. So one very important point is you should start giving a grant test when your 19 subjects are done. Once your first read about the 19 subject is done, then only you should give a grant test, because grant test will have a question from all 19 subjects. What happens if you have covered half subject, like 10 subject you are done, and now you are giving a grant test. Now, you know, there is always overlap. Some anatomic questions can be answered by surgical knowledge. Some surgical questions can be answered by anatomy knowledge. As I have said in my previous videos also, that physiopathopharma helps you answering medicine questions. So you should be ready with your 19 subject. Do not give grant test unless and until your 19 subjects are over. Otherwise, it is going to give you a false impression that your particular subject is strong or a particular subject is weak. So do not give grant test unless and until your all reading of your 19 subject is done. Now, whenever we give a grant test, we have certain kind of results, like the result will come out. So they'll give you a rank, like what is your rank? So rank will be given around, like suppose you have 160 rank or something like that. It will be given. Then they will give you a score out of, let's say out of 800 if they want to give. So they will give you a score as well. And they will give you a performance. They will give you a performance of the data they will give you after your grant test is over. So result will be in this form. You get a rank, you get a score, and you get a subject wise analysis. So there are two things they give. Sometimes they give percentage, that how you have fared in each subject, like anatomy, if your score was like 80% accuracy. I mean, they tell about accuracy, like physiology 60%, biochemistry 55%, pathology again 60%. So that is how they give. And another is percentile. Some grant test and at the end they will give you percentile. Percentile means out of the students, like if your rank is 160 out of, let's say 2000 students had given this grant test. So if your percentile is 95, that means 95% students are below you. I mean, you have scored better than 95% of the students who have given the particular test. So that is what is important, but we have to look for the percentage. So this is what overview is. So rank, score, and your subject wise performance, and the answer and explanations are also there. So I want to come to the straight to the topic. So what is the ideal way to analyze a grant test? So most of the students, as I have said in earlier, they are very excited about the rank and score. Everybody wants to see what rank they got and what score they got. So guys, this is a very wrong method, and we should not look for rank and score, because this is not a real indication. It will not reciprocate in your exam. It is not a real proof of your performance. See what happens if there are three students. One person who had covered the 30% of the syllabus, like who is good in 30% of the syllabus, who is good in 50% of the syllabus, and who had covered the 70% of the syllabus, like he knows 70% of the things, everything about it. Now, you know, GTs, you'll get either 200 or 300 questions. Now, you know how GTs are made. Like your NEET, PG or NICT, this exam will be, these questions will be made by the faculties, and they have to just make a one question paper. So they will put everything, like subject-wise weightage, there will be overlap, but that will be a good form paper. GTs, there are so many grant tests in each app of each classes. So they'll take the question from the Q bank, and the GTs are formed, like, but same some certain number of questions from each subject. So if most of the questions come from your 30% of what you have read, or the question bank which you have covered, you know, in some duties you will feel like, okay, your performance is very good and you will be happy and you will feel like you are going well. But in next duty, the remaining questions from the remaining 70% will come, and again you will feel like, you know, your GT score will fluctuate. Similarly happens for the 50%. If the question comes from your 50% of the data that you have read, your performance will be good. But again, if the most of the questions from the other part of 50%, your performance will dip down. But if you have covered 70% of your portion well, then you will have a steady graph. You will not have much fluctuations and you will have a good rank and score. But that is what happened. We are never prepared and we are just keen to know the rank and score. And that is the reason our GT score and GT rank does not reciprocate in the final exam. So guys, I have said again and again, do not go for the rank and score in your grand test. What you should look for? First, subject-wise performance. What I have showed in the previous slide, look how much accuracy you have scored in 80%. See how much accuracy in physiology, biochemistry, pathology. You have to check for accuracy in this subject. You have to see how much you are progressing. You have to see that how is your subject-wise performance. Okay, that is the first thing. Second, you have to notify your weak areas. You have to mark, okay, in dermatology, STDs, I'm doing mistakes again and again. In physiology, nephro is causing trouble. CNS is causing trouble. In biochemistry, suppose particular amino acids disorder, I'm making a lot of mistakes. So you have to assess these weak areas in this grand test. Now, you know, there are two things in whenever you are dealing in medical entrance examination. One is perfection and one is progress. So what should you aim for is progress and not for the perfection. See, we have 19 subjects. You cannot achieve perfection in a subject. Many students go for subject-wise test and, you know, if they get wrong in one subject, they try to read it again and again and go back to the topic. See, we don't have to achieve perfection in one subject. We have to have a good amount of command on all subjects. So you have to assess your progression. You have to see, okay, last time my anatomy performance was 60%, my accuracy was 60%, my percentage was 60%, now it has become 68%. So this is the progress that you have to assess. Even a small progress, like if your physiology was 58%, but now you're doing 62%, okay, so that is better. That progress you have to assess with each GT. You have to not achieve the perfection. We don't have to go for the 100%. So these three things, your subject-wise importance, assessing of weak areas, and your progress. These are the three important things that we have to assess in grand test. Now, guys, let me tell you one very important thing that whenever we are, what should be our targets? Now, what is the ideal way to go for the GTs? Now, if you must be remembering this slide from my NEET PG analysis. So I had done one NEET PG 2021 question, recall question analysis from different classes and review books. So I just wanted to tell you that these, you know, my concept of, so these basically the first and second prof subjects. So these are our rank building subject. Okay. So these are our rank maintaining subject. And these are our rank deciding subject. So now what we have to do, whenever we assess a GT, if you notice that 137 question out of 200, which happened in November 2021, you can tackle them from your rank building subject of your knowledge. So if you have a consistent and high accuracy in this subject, you can solve 68.5% of the question from your question paper. Okay. And remaining 63 questions were from, you can tackle from your rest rank maintaining and rank deciding subject. So you should aim for higher accuracy in rank building subject as compared to the rank deciding and rank maintaining subject. So whenever you are analyzing your GT, as I said in my last slide, you have to go for the subject-wise performance. So you have to know that, okay, these are my green subjects in green are my most important subject and I should give them the more important point. So just, I have made this one representation slide. So our rank mentoring subject, you have to target accuracy up to 80 to 85%. Now you'll say, sir, this appears a very huge, like humongous task to achieve 80 to 85%. But let me tell you one thing, it is to have this accuracy is possible only in rank building subject, because most of these subjects, not most, all of these subjects are fact based. You know, anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, that does not change over a decade. Pharmacology, yes, few new drugs, otherwise it does not change much. Microbiology, yes, COVID is addition. Apart from that, everything is the same. Pathology, again, the same things, same and same questions are coming again and again. Even if you ask a topper, like the the person who topped NEET PG 2021, he got 182 right. And trust me, guys, even when I got my rank, my basic command was on my rank building subject, and my accuracy was highest on rank building subject. So whenever you write your GT, make sure you aim for highest accuracy in rank building subject, which are your first and second prof subject, which are six, initial six. The rank building subject, I have kept nine subjects. I'm talking about first six subjects: anatomy, physiology, biochemistry, pathophysiopharma, patho, micro and pharma. So these six subjects, you should aim for the highest accuracy. So you have to work them on them well. Now about PEETs, ophthalmology, yes, they are also, I include them in a rank building subject, but they're a little bit difficult to score as compared to this subject. So you can compromise for a little bit lower, 70 to 75% of the accuracy. So on an average, you can aim for around 77% of the accuracy in rank building subject. So I told you in my previous slide, in NEET PG 2021, 137 questions were from rank building subject. So if you have an accuracy of 77%, see, what I always talk about is consistency is the key for success in NEET PG or any PG entrance examination. So not only consistency in the studies, but consistency in your performance. So you should make sure that you should not dip down below 80% in this subject. So on an average, if you combine this all rank building subject, if you make out of 137, if your accuracy is 77%, you can get around 106 questions right. Now, if you go to rank maintenance subject, these are our big four, or PSM, medicine, surgery, and obs gyne. So yes, it's vast. Medicine keep changing. They ask a lot of difficult questions, clinical based question, can be confusing, can be confusion between two answers, can be some latest advances. Surgery also, sometimes they ask very difficult question, you're not able to answer. PSM can be tricky sometimes, but still they are very, I mean, if you cover the important topics, you can definitely score better. So you can definitely, it's okay to accept 60 to 70% of the accuracy. See, what I'm giving here is minimum. That minimum accuracy in this your subject should be 60 to 70%. You can definitely aim for higher, and you should aim for higher. Then coming to the ranks of deciding subject, again, these are short subjects, which are your psychiatry, anesthesia, FMT, ortho, radio, and derma. So again, these are again fact-based questions. There is no, like, you don't get a lot of new questions from these. Again, the same and same questions are repeated with a twist or a different. So again, you have to aim a little bit higher, because if you revise your PYQs, previous year questions, your rank deciding subject accuracy would be more. So aim for at least 70 to 80% accuracy in your rank deciding subject. These are the short subject. You can accept a little lesser accuracy in rank maintaining subject, but this is where you have to work the maximum rank building subject. This is what going to help you getting a rank. Now, if I put all these things together, you will ask me, sir, how does it affect? How does it make sense if I achieve this accuracy in GTs? So if you combine these two, rank mentoring and rank deciding subject, on an average, if you consider that 65% of the accuracy you get in these two subject mean. So there were 137 questions. So out of that 106 you get. So remaining 63 questions, if you go for 65% of the accuracy, you'll get around 41 questions right in this subject. So if you combine these two, if you add these two, you get 147 questions right out of 200. If you consistently improve your accuracy to that level, okay? And I'm telling you, it's not a joke. You can see rank building subject, you can definitely go for, I mean, initial six subject, you can definitely have a higher accuracy. You have to read more. People treat anatomy as a short subject. You can... you can see the number of questions you get from anatomy, number of questions you get from patho, pharma, micro, like you are able to tackle. So that's why don't treat them as a minor subject. They are the most important subject of your PG preparation. So this is where you get 147 questions you get right out of 200. And where, if you have 147 right out of 200, this is where you end up, somewhere between 8,000 to 13,000. So I have just told you the minimum. You can definitely improve in out of 60%, you can improve it to more like 70%, 78%. So you can see the accuracy of the student. So what I'm trying to tell you, that rank 1,000 to 10,000 will fetch you any seat you want, from radiology, medicine, surgery, ENT, ophtha, whatever seat you want. So you can see the accuracy of the students from, like, combined accuracy. This is from NEET PG 2021 result. So 82% accuracy, 76.5, 74.5. So this is a combined accuracy of all subjects. This is where you need to work on. This is actually what happens. You have to give importance to the subject that has more weightage, and that is going to give you the better result. So this is where you have, this is how you should analyze your GT, not by your rank. Now, how do I improve my GT outcome? So whenever you are done with your GT, if you're analyzing a subject, like for example, if you're analyzing your rank building subject now, so first you have to categorize your questions. So first would be the questions that you got correct and which are there in your notes. So you don't have to do anything for this subject because already they are covered in your notes. You don't have to do anything separately. You just have to keep reading your notes and you'll get them right no matter how many times you come to your exam. Second is the number of questions which you got correct by the guesswork or by like chance. So you have to mark these questions. You have to take a screenshot so you can just revisit it again that, okay, you did a very intelligent guess, but maybe if it appears in exam, you might get it wrong. And the third category, the questions which you got incorrect. So now you have to see why you got them incorrect. Maybe it was a database questions, or it was a conceptual mistake, or it was a silly mistake. If it is a data-based question, just add it to your notes, a single line, or take a screenshot. If it is a conceptual question, and if it is from a very important topic, you have to read and understand the concept again, that, okay, why you got the question wrong? Because again, something else will be asked. If it is a silly mistake, just tell yourself that, okay, I need to see if you read the question wrong, or if you misinterpreted it, that you have to analyze from yourself. So you can improve on this silly mistake. So you categorize by these three and then you process them accordingly. Now, if it is a database, you can directly take a screenshot. Now, one important adding material to the notes. A lot of students say, sir, when I solve GT, I get in explanation, can I add that explanation to my notes so I don't have to go. See, guys, whatever I talk about notes, what I mean is notes is a concise material. Like, it's very concise. We have notes are easy to revise. Don't add so much stuff to the note that you make a textbook out of it, but another book that it becomes difficult to revise. What you can do is you have to trust your memory. Once you read thing, you don't have to add everything to your notes. You can add like single line, single word that you feel important. You don't have to add the subject or their explanation exactly like that. You don't have to do that. So don't add too much to the notes. You can take screenshot and you can read there only. You read with the focus. Keep your mind and your eyes there. So that is what you should do to improve your GT's outcome. Now, this is also a very important question, that how many GT's to give. So guys, let me tell you first about GT. So GT's are usually for 3 hours. Usually the time duration is 3 hours. But I can tell you honestly, sitting here, that 70% out of you finish their GT in 2 hours. The reason, because you're excited to see your rank and your score. You're not bothered that what mistakes you're doing. You just want to go for the rank. So that is the reason most of the students finish their GT in 2 and 2.5 hours. But in exam, they find time management their time management is very bad. In exam, they feel that the time is not enough. So guys, 3 hours you're spending writing a GT. Then another 2 hours you need to analyze the GT. That, okay, I have been just to see the answer and the question and what you have got wrong. Then after that, if your result is good, you'll be happy and you'll be telling everyone, okay, I gave GT. You'll be sending a screenshot to your friend, your family, everyone, that I got this rank and I'm very happy. And you'll stay elated for a few days. If the score is low, you start feeling sad. And another 5-7 hours, you are in the sadness. Okay, maybe I will not do it. I will not get my branch and you become sad. Maybe for 1 week. And then you will not tell anyone because you will keep this score to yourself. So these 3 plus 2, and there are infinite hours that you spend on being happy or being sad. So on an average, what I'm trying to tell you here, that you spend 7 to 8 hours when you write GT. Like 3 hours giving, 2 hours analyzing, and 4-5 hours thinking about it. Okay, what went wrong? So if you spend so many, even if you just remove this thinking part, you have to spend around 5 hours in one GT. So if you give 4 or 5 GTs a month, you almost spend one total day on GTs. So what I feel like that is a too much time. I mean, in 5 hours, you can cover, if you give those 24 hours for reading, you can cover a lot more and you can improve your outcome by a lot. So what ideal I feel, that maximum you should go for 2 to 3, not more than. I feel 2 is ideal, that every 2 weeks you write your GT. or like two in 1 month. So that is, I feel, the better way. And when your exam approaches near, like in the last month, you can go for three. Like initially two, like in the month of Jan, you can go for two, and in Feb mid, you can go for last. In the last 1 month, you can give three GTs. I think that is the best time you can do. I mean, giving more time for GTs, I don't think it is going to help you a lot. See, students who are toppers for interview, we watch like rank one, two, three, four. Because they already have completed the 19 subject. They're just assessing themselves, so they can give lot on lot GTs. Your first priority it should be to cover the portion, because your questions are not going to come from the GTs, but from the portion that you are reading. So finish your portion first and then start giving you GTs. GTs are not going to give you a rank. GTs meant for the practice, and your practice will become perfect when your source is perfect, when your reading is perfect. So that's all, guys. That's what all I want to say about GTs. I hope it helps. And if you have any questions and doubt, let me know in the comment box. I wish you all the best. Take care.